Hey everybody, welcome back. This is Mr. Miller here once again, and this is Thursday the 21st of May already. Thursday the 21st of May. This weekend is Memorial Day, so just a quick update. We're not going to do anything on Monday, Memorial Day, since that's a federal holiday. We get that day off, so that's nice, but then also good to remember what it's about as our fallen soldiers. For our country. Anyways, just so you know, we don't have school on Monday or don't have class on Monday. So today we're going to be jumping into our final chapter of the year, I guess. The final course content that we'll cover is topic 19 and 20. Topic 19 and 20. So we will be working on that for give or take the next 2.5 weeks up until the early days of June, and then we will more or less kind of be wrapping up, tying up some loose ends for the year. So without any further ado, let's jump right into topic 19 through 20 notes. Let me slide over a little bit. So topic 19 and 20 notes. Let's jump right into this. Number one here, we're starting with, I guess I should say, if you are on this Google Classroom page, which you are, you should find a copy of the PowerPoint and a copy of the notes, so you can use both of those as you need to. But I would definitely have the copy of the notes open or in a separate tab or open in front of you or print it off or whatever, so then you can use those and copy those down as you go. So topic 19 through 20. Let's get going. Number one, liberal versus conservative ideals. So in the 1970s, we have a big divide between liberals and conservatives. And we have kind of competing ideas on how the government operates, how the government is going to run, how the government works best. And those different ideas are usually held by liberals on one side and conservatives on the other side. So where we need to go here is kind of talking about both sides to begin with. So liberals, to begin with, in the 1970s, think that government should play more of an active role in improving the lives of Americans in general. The government's job is to make American lives better, is kind of the liberal perspective there. You see this through a bunch of different ideas, helping the poor, helping the elderly, helping minorities, helping women, providing women's, giving women's rights and more opportunities for women. Also advocating for cracking down on big businesses and industries that are abusing normal people, right? So make life better for normal Americans is kind of the feeling for liberals. Conservatives, on the other hand, are kind of the mindset that government often kind of gets in the way of the good things in America, like business and like making money and prosperity. So the government gets in that way, or in the way of those things. The government hurts economic growth. The government tries to fix social problems, and it's not really the government's job to fix those social problems, conservatives would say. The government tries to fix economic issues, and all they end up doing is over-regulating, getting their business or getting caught into too many different things. So those perspectives from conservatives would advocate for limited government. Okay, government size is going to be limited. There's going to be less regulations from the government. The government is also going to be spending less money through these conservative principles. Spend less money, regulate less, allow the economy to kind of do what it's going to do and allow people to make money and don't get in the way of that. You also have kind of this desire, like I said, economic freedom, but also kind of this desire to go back to a better time when the morals of our country were stronger. So, for example, conservatives at this point would generally be in favor of like traditional marriage, family structure, just advocating for as strong of families, going to churches, those sorts of things, that a lot of liberals would not have advocated for. They are also wary of communism, conservatives are. They see liberalism as one step away from communism, so that's why they're kind of worried a little bit here about liberalism. So how does this all kind of get into the 1980s? Because that's where we're going to kind of pick up here. Having known all that we know about liberalism and conservatism in those two major perspectives, we have to talk about a couple major individuals, a few major individuals. I guess there's three that we'll talk about, and then one more. So these major individuals are responsible for kind of pushing forward this conservative idea, I guess, or the conservative ideas, pushing forward ideals of conservatism. So in the 1960s and 70s, there is a growth of conservatism, and it's starting very slowly, but it is starting. There are conservative individuals that are very, very influential, that are gaining traction here. One of them, his name is Milton Friedman. The other one that you can write down here is, her name is Phyllis Schlafly, or Schlafly, Schlafly, Schlafly. I just call her Phyllis Schlafly. I'm missing the L in there. I fully understand that, but that's what I call her, Phyllis Schlafly. It's easier for me to do so because I cannot pronounce Schlafly. Yeah, I think that's right. So to start with, Milton Friedman, down here in the bottom, the bald guy who's smiling, he is an economist and he is a conservative. He has interesting ideas about the economy and how the economy can best support its workers. And he says, you know, government's kind of got to get out of the way on this. Okay, get out of the economic realm in large ways, in large numbers, I guess, and allow the economy to do what it's got to do. Up here in the top left-hand corner is Phyllis Schlafly. I just can't do it. It's Phyllis S. Okay, Phyllis S. Right there in the top left-hand corner, Phyllis S. So Phyllis S. is responsible for advocating for kind of the fact that women have a lot of rights already, and they don't need extra precautions to guarantee those rights. So one thing that she's advocating to do is to reject what's called the Equal Rights Amendment, which we had talked about in the last unit, the Equal Rights Amendment, that amendment that would have been in the Constitution that would have guaranteed equal rights for men and women. Phyllis, I'm sorry for the yawn, that's number one. Phyllis S. would have said, you know, women have enough rights already, and there's no real oppression, and women are not being abused or taken advantage of, so this Equal Rights Amendment is kind of pointless. So she was kind of a conservative voice on the female side, which is interesting, because at this point there weren't a ton of females who were more on the conservative side, at least that were super vocal. There were plenty, but not super vocal at this point. Also, we have the rise of a group or a movement that is called the Moral Majority. The Moral Majority. The Moral Majority was a group, it's a political organization, but it is founded by a famous gentleman, and he's pictured over here. I don't have his name written on my board, but you can write it down if you want to. His name is Jerry Falwell. Jerry Falwell. Jerry Falwell eventually ends up creating a college called Liberty University, which you might have heard of. Liberty University is a large Christian college in America. But him, at this point, he is advocating for this political organization called the Moral Majority. And the Moral Majority, the goal for the Moral Majority is to fight back and preserve religious goals, and preserve the traditional family, the morals of our country, the Moral Majority. So provide for the traditional morals of our country. Now, he starts to also question major court cases that have come down in the 60s and 70s, some of those very liberal court cases that we talked about probably 2 or 3 weeks ago at this point, those court cases being Roe v. Wade being the abortion case, and then also Engle versus Vital, which did not allow for prayer in public schools. So disallowed prayer in public schools. So he is, and his organization, the Moral Majority, are fighting back against those decisions as much as they can. But those decisions still end up staying, I guess. So yeah, they do. Now let's go on to the man of the hour. His name would be Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan is a very well-known president. Lots of conservatives still to this day like him a lot. And he's a charismatic guy, so he's kind of like for Democrats and John F. Kennedy or FDR, those really, really high-profile Democrats. Republicans is kind of Ronald Reagan. He's kind of the one that everybody kind of gravitates to if you are of that political affiliation. Now, Ronald Reagan, he starts out as a Democrat in his life. He is a very interesting guy because he started out also as an actor in Hollywood. He was like into newscasting or radio broadcasting or whatever, but then he ended up getting into acting in his younger years, and Hollywood tended to be a very liberal place. So he was a New Deal Democrat was what he was. He was supportive of FDR, supportive of those programs, that massive expansion of the government in the 1930s and 40s. So Reagan starts out as a Democrat. Very quickly, though, in the 1960s, he starts criticizing the big government, and government is just gaining power and gaining their responsibilities and starting to really take control of a lot of different areas that they didn't have control over before. So he starts to be very critical of that, dislikes the big government, dislikes communists in government and potential for that, just does not like any of those developments that America is kind of dealing with. So what does he do? He becomes a Republican, and he becomes the governor of the most populous state in the country. That would be California, which at the time California elected Republican governors. Nowadays, Republicans have about as much chance of winning in California as I do of going to the moon. It's very, very low. I mean, not saying it's impossible. If anybody's got a free ticket to the moon, I'll go. But yeah, it's not happening nowadays. So Ronald Reagan, governor of California, ends up running for president in 1980. Now, he is running against the Democrat. His name is Jimmy Carter. We talked about him last week. I guess this would have been on Wednesday of last week, on the 13th. So Jimmy Carter is the president. Not the greatest president. Didn't really have a lot that he did that was super awesome. Remember, is that number two? I'm sorry, I lost count. I apologize for the yawn. Jimmy Carter, remember, he had a bunch of hostages that were taken by the Iranians, the Iranian hostage crisis, the Iran hostage crisis. They were held in Iran for like 444 days. Also, the economy wasn't the greatest. We were dealing with what they call stagflation. Remember, stagnant economy, high unemployment, coupled with inflation, which usually doesn't happen. So Ronald Reagan comes into this presidential election, and all he really does is he runs a very simple campaign. He says, and this is kind of one of his main points. He says, you know, ask yourself. He says to the normal American, he says, ask yourself, are you better off now than you were 4 years ago? If you are better off now than you were 4 years ago, then congrats. Whatever Jimmy Carter did worked for you. So vote for Jimmy Carter. But if you are not better off than you were 4 years ago, which he bet that more people were worse off than they were 4 years ago, then that means Jimmy Carter is not the right president for you because he's hurting you. So you should vote for Ronald Reagan. You should vote for me, he says. So he was right. A majority of Americans thought that they were worse off than they were 4 years before. So you end up with Ronald Reagan winning pretty handily here. Ronald Reagan wins over 50% of the popular vote. Jimmy Carter had 41%, and there was a third-party candidate named Anderson in there who won almost 7%, which is a decently sized number for a third-party candidate. Anyways, Ronald Reagan wins almost all of the states in the Union. He only loses 5 states and the District of Columbia to ride to pretty much a landslide in this election. This is not his biggest election. His next election was even bigger, though. So I don't know if I'll talk about that one specifically. He ends up winning like all but one state or all but 2 states. It's pretty easy for him to win. Anyways, that's Ronald Reagan here. Now, let's go on to number 3. This is going to be the last slide that we go through today. I find that we take a lot longer to go through 19 and 20, topics 19 and 20, than we do some other topics, so we kind of slow down as we go. So we're only going to try to do 3 every day, and hopefully I'm going to stick to 20 minutes. I don't know if it's going to happen, but we're going to try. So I think if I stopped trying to say Phyllis S.'s name so much, I think I probably could have saved myself probably a minute of this video. Anyways, economics and social issues under Ronald Reagan. There is an economic policy that Ronald Reagan uses to his advantage in the 1980s, and it is called Reaganomics. Okay, Reaganomics. Just like economics, but Reaganomics. Reagan economics. Reaganomics. That's where they get it from. I know, you might not have figured that out on your own, but that's why I'm here to tell you this. Okay, that is why I teach you. So, Reaganomics. Ronald Reagan has this idea, and he says, oh, it's also called, I guess I should write this on the board. Let me write it right now. Okay, through the magic of television, I've written it on the board. So it is also called supply-side economics. Supply-side economics. So I would write that in there as well. So Reaganomics or supply-side economics, it is very different from the previous economic ideas that we have kind of been operating in under for probably the last 80 years in America. 90 years, really. Or no, 40 or 50 years, 50 years. From 1980 back to like the New Deal. So FDR, remember, he was very, very, very new in thought. Herbert Hoover used an idea where he said, okay, well, let's let businesses give jobs back to people during this Great Depression. Let's give money to businesses. Let's allow them to hire new workers and pay for those workers to work at their factories, whatever. That is basically supply-side economics, okay? So that is what we had operated under before the Great Depression. Now, FDR comes in, and he does what they call economic pump priming, if you remember. Pump priming, meaning that FDR is going to pump money into the economy through the people, and those people are going to then spend it, and that's going to be kind of what they do, okay? So that's kind of the idea. Now, Ronald Reagan, like I said, very different. He uses supply-side economics, which is what Herbert Hoover used unsuccessfully during the Great Depression, might I add. So unsuccessfully. However, Ronald Reagan kind of makes it work pretty well. So what he decides to do is he says, okay, well, I'm going to lower taxes on the wealthiest of Americans. If I lower taxes on the rich, then the rich are going to invest more. They're going to spend more money hiring people. They're going to allow more people to work. Those people are going to make money, and then those people are going to be active in the economy, and then that's going to be a big cycle that kind of gets the economy rolling again, rather than pumping money directly into the economy. Just cut taxes. It's a different way to go about it, basically. Ronald Reagan ends up cutting taxes by 23% over the course of the first couple years in office. Okay, 23%. So you can see here kind of a depiction on the right-hand side here. This is often what I think of when I think of supply-side economics. It's got little baby Ronald Reagan there. They should have like a censored bar over his backside there because that's not appropriate. Anyways, maybe I could do that. Maybe I could put like a little black bar over it or a blurred out area. I don't know how to do that on my like basic computer. I don't know. Maybe I could figure it out. Anyways, pouring money into the top class, it's going to trickle down, okay? It will get down to the middle class, and it will get down to the poor class. This is what they call trickle-down economics as well, trickle-down economics. So there's like 18 different names for Reaganomics, supply-side economics, trickle-down economics, yeah. So a bunch of different names for it. However, they are... somewhat successful, okay? So I'll show you here, and then I'll talk about some of the negatives of it. So we have a, this chart shows inflation, okay? The amount of, or the percent that our nation's money supply is growing over each year. So remember stagflation, really high inflation, not good. You want to have a very healthy inflation, and for our country, that's about 2%. 2% inflation every year is pretty healthy. That's a good economy. We were at like 15% in the 1970s. 15. So what ends up happening is he cuts taxes, the inflation drops, and we go into a recession in 1981, 82 era-ish. So we enter into a corrective recession that is basically what they would say is that there was some major issues with the economy, and either we were going to fix them now by going into a recession, or we were going to fix them later by going into a bigger recession or a depression. So you can't keep putting off the issue further and further down the road. It will come back to bite you eventually. So we go into a recession here, and unemployment goes up and the economy tanks, but then it goes back, it comes back, and the economy does pretty well in the rest of the 1980s after we get through 82, 83. So you can see here that the issue of inflation has more or less been solved by this policy or by these policies. By 1983, we're down to 3% inflation, 10% lower than it was before Ronald Reagan took office. All the way in 1986, we're down to a healthy inflation rate, and then it kind of goes up again from there a little bit. So it's not perfect, but it helped. It did help. Now, what I would say is that the economy was more or less improved, okay, but there were some issues with this trickle-down economics, and they're shown by, or one of them is shown by this, I guess both of them are shown by this picture here. So the statement, the rich get richer and the poor get poorer, is a statement that applies here because the rich make more money, the rich get the biggest benefit out of this, and then some of it trickles down to the middle class, not a lot of it trickles down to the poor. So the gap between the rich and the poor widens during this time, gets wider and wider. So yeah, poverty increases, the wage gap increases, and that's ultimately not a good thing. So it's not a perfect thing. Very few economic policies are perfect. I would probably say none of them are. Anyways, Ronald Reagan ends up appointing, I guess we got to talk about social issues real quick, then we'll be done. I totally missed my 20-minute target, by the way. We'll see if we can do that again tomorrow. I don't know. So he ends up appointing the first woman to ever serve in the Supreme Court. Usually we would think of Democrats as being more female-friendly, in terms of policies, but the first woman to ever serve in the Supreme Court was appointed by a Republican, Ronald Reagan. Her name is Sandra Day O'Connor. Sandra Day O'Connor, or Sandra Day O'Connor. Nice Irish last name. Sandra Day O'Connor, she is, like I said, the first woman to be appointed to the Supreme Court. She is also one of three individuals that Ronald Reagan puts on the Supreme Court, and they are all conservatives. And so he kind of balances out the Supreme Court and makes it a very balanced body that is still more or less balanced today with a decent number of conservatives and a decent number of liberals on the court. So next up here, we got to talk about one more thing. So there's in the 1960s and 70s, drug use was running rampant, and we were also dealing with an epidemic of AIDS, autoimmunodeficiency syndrome, I think is what it stands for. But HIV, AIDS, you guys know what that is, hopefully. I'm sure you do. I said AIDS one time in class, and people looked at me like I had three heads, like, what? We've never heard of that before. I know that's a lie. Okay, so HIV, AIDS, it was a big thing back in the 80s. It's not really a huge thing right now, but it was way bigger in the 80s. It felt like a lot of people were getting it, and it was a deadly disease. You did not recover from AIDS. And nowadays, there's medicine to treat it and more or less maintain a lifestyle that's normal and not really die from it. Magic Johnson, look at him. He's technically got HIV, but he hasn't really had any issues with it. Anyways, at this point, AIDS is a big thing, and there's kind of overuse of drugs. I mean, overuse of drugs. Pretty much any use of drugs is overuse, most people would say. Anyways, this leads to Ronald Reagan implementing more research for AIDS and counteracting AIDS, but also implementing what he calls the war on drugs. So the war on drugs, trying to limit the use of illegal substances and really crack down on drugs and how they are consumed and how they're passed around and all that stuff. So I think that's all I got for you today. I will post, there will be two questions that are posted alongside this video. So go into the separate page there on the Google Classroom, the separate post, the assignment, and answer those two questions. You should have those in, where's that blue light coming from? I don't know where that blue light is coming from. There's a blue light on my hand. Where is it? I don't even know. I don't know. I'm confused. So two questions. Answer those two questions, and then we're done. We'll be back. Tomorrow's a catch-up day. We'll be back with notes again on Tuesday because Monday's Memorial Day. So catch-up day tomorrow, Memorial Day Monday, back to notes on Tuesday. So with that being said, I will see you then. Bye.